Welcome, grade 11 to Edu-ca-te. Let's just do this question on this nephron. This is based on excretion in human beings. So I strongly recommend you to watch my videos on the nephron and what processes take place or what processes occur at the nephron. You definitely have understanding on how to tackle this exercise. So now the diagram below represents a certain portion of a nephron. You can see that it's a certain portion. It's not really the whole nephron. If you can see well, you can see that part A, it is this first part that has got a cup-shaped thing, and part B looks like a tube. So we already have ideas on what's happening there. And we can see that there are arrows here that indicates that something is coming from part E, and it is moving into this cup, into this place, into this cup. So these arrows are very important to interpret them. So now they say we should identify part A. You can see that part A here is representing this whole part that has got a cup shape. Most of the times in the nephron, something that has got a cup shape is it's connected to the Malpighian body. So part A is actually the Malpighian body, because you can see that it is involving, or it is including all the parts F, E, D, and C. So we can see that F is that that efferent arteriole, if I'm not mistaken. Oh no, F is the Bowman's capsule. E is the glomerulus, and then F is actually an efferent arteriole. E is the glomerulus, D is the afferent arteriole, and C is the Bowman's capsule. You can see that here, these arrows suggest that something is happening here, something is moving from the glomerulus, and you already know what it is, right? So part A, it is what? It is the Malpighian body. So it is the Malpighian body. And then part B, they say we should also identify it. You don't have to explain anything. You're just telling them what is which part. So part B, you can see that it is the region that follows after the Malpighian body, and that is the proximal convoluted tubule. So it is the proximal convoluted tubule. So this is what happens. So these are your two marks. Your first two marks is the Malpighian body and proximal convoluted tubule. And then now 2.2.2 asks, name the process that takes place at part A. If we say part A is the Malpighian body, what process takes place at the Malpighian body? You know that it is known as what? Glomerular filtration. So it is known as glomerular filtration. It is known as glomerular filtration. Or other textbooks can say it is ultrafiltration, still referring to the same thing. So don't think that it's anything different. Glomerular filtration or ultrafiltration means the exact same thing. This is the process whereby smaller dissolved substances actually does what? They move from the blood in the glomerulus, and then they move into the Bowman's capsule. They are being filtered. Hence, we say it is known as glomerular filtration. So that's another mark.
Do you want to get more benefits from this channel? From only 20 rands per month, you too could become a member and get exclusive benefits and even private tutoring. Click join on our channel page to find out.
And then B asks us to name the process that takes place at B. So remember, we've said that at part B, it is known as the proximal convoluted tubule. So what actually happens at the proximal convoluted tubule? Remember, the process is known as tubular reabsorption. So it is known as tubular reabsorption. So this is where important nutrients move from this proximal convoluted tubule. They move into the back into the surrounding blood vessels. You can see that here they are moving back into the surrounding blood vessels. So this process whereby important nutrients move into surrounding blood vessels is known as the tubular reabsorption. So that is another mark as well. And then let's go now to 2.2.3. Now it's no longer free marks. So 2.2.3 says, explain why blood vessel D and F are structurally different in size. So let us identify blood vessels D and F. So D, we have said that is your afferent arteriole. And then F, we have said that is your efferent arteriole. Why do we even say that? We can see that they are different in structure, their size, are different. Remember that always the afferent arteriole is wider than the efferent arteriole. So that is why I said D is the afferent arteriole, whereas F is the efferent one. Although this diagram makes it look like this is not an arteriole, but F is an efferent arteriole. So now we have to explain what is that structural difference. So the thing is, D is wider than F. Or you can even substitute D for afferent arteriole. You can say that the afferent arteriole is wider than the efferent arteriole. It's still referring to the same thing because here you are just given what? You are just given labels D and F. So here D is wider than F, meaning that the afferent arteriole is wider than the efferent arteriole. What is the advantage? Remember that the advantage of the difference in the size is that when the blood is entering in a large surface area and it is leaving in a small surface area, the blood will be put under pressure. So this will cause the blood to be put under pressure. This causes the blood to be put under pressure. So remember that pressure exists when something is moving in a smaller area. So if it moves in here at the afferent arteriole in a wider afferent arteriole, and then it leaves in a narrower efferent arteriole, this blood that is in the glomerulus will feel a lot of pressure. Remember that the blood is moving like this, right, into the glomerulus. So just bear in mind that if you don't understand what I'm talking about here, I recommend that you still watch our video on glomerular filtration and the processes. So this causes the blood to be put under pressure. And when the blood is put under pressure, remember what happens? The smaller dissolved substances will move away. They will be filtered from the blood. So this, when the blood is under pressure, small dissolved substances will be filtered, or you can say that will move into the capsular space, will move into the capsular space. So when I'm talking about the capsular space, I'm just talking about the Bowman's capsule. So here you can say that these arrows, these black arrows, these dark arrows are representing that there's something that is moving from the part A, which is the glomerulus, into the cup, into part C, which is the Bowman's capsule. So the smaller dissolved substances will move into the capsular space. So I think you can just add that this whole process that's happening here, I'm not sure which one is the fourth mark here. I've not yet checked the memo, but then I think this is enough to get you 4 marks. I don't know how they allocated the marks, but then as long as you explain that because D, which is the afferent arteriole, is wider than F, which is the efferent arteriole, this will cause the blood to be put under pressure. Maybe that is around 2 marks. And then this blood, when it is put under pressure, the small dissolved substances will move into the capsular space or into the Bowman's capsule. And then glomerular filtration, this process here would have taken place. So now let us go now to the next question. The next question, 2.2.4, asks what components of blood in part E are absent from the fluid in part C. So this is quite a bit of a higher order. Now we need to analyze carefully. So in part C, when we're talking about part C, we're talking about this Bowman's capsule. This is the cup region. This is part C for us. So in part C, what do we usually find? Remember that we usually find the glomerular filtrate, right? So here, inside here, we're gonna find the glomerular filtrate. And the glomerular filtrate, remember that it is just made up of those smaller dissolved substances that have moved from the blood. So when they are here, we say it is known as a glomerular filtrate. So now they want to know which components of the blood, are present. They say in part E, in the glomerulus, are absent in the fluid in part C. So what is found in part E and not found in part C? So let's look again at part E. So if we're looking at part E, we can see that part E here, it is the glomerulus, this region, the glomerulus. So remember that the blood in the glomerulus here, it is the one that is being filtered. So what can we find in this blood that we will not be able to find in part C? So in the glomerular filtrate, remember that the glomerular filtrate just contains what? Smaller dissolved substances. Otherwise, the bigger proteins or the larger proteins will remain inside the blood, because the whole aim is to just filter out those smaller dissolved substances. So we'll say that smaller dissolved substances are found in part C as well as in part E, because they are being filtered from part E, right? But you cannot find larger proteins in part C. The question says, what components in part E are absent in the fluid in part C? What components found in this blood are absent here at the glomerular filtrate? So here, we're gonna say that those are what? Larger proteins. So larger proteins, remember, they always remain in the blood. I even made a video on this as well, on the adaptations of the glomerulus. So larger proteins always remain in the blood. They do not get filtered here during the process of ultrafiltration. And then what else there? We can say the blood cells. The blood cells do not actually get filtered as well. The blood cells remain inside the blood at the glomerulus. But only the smaller dissolved substances will be the ones that will be found at the glomerular filtrate. I hope I'm making sense. Then now let's go to point number 2.2.5. So 2.2.5 says we must explain how the structure labeled part B is structurally suited for its function. So part B, remember, is the proximal convoluted tubule, and its function is tubular reabsorption, is to reabsorb. Yeah, it is to make sure that if there are any important nutrients here at the proximal convoluted tubule, they will move back into the what? Back into the surrounding blood vessels or the peritubular capillaries. So now, how is it structurally suited? So the proximal convoluted tubule has got many mitochondria. So for the process of tubular reabsorption to occur, we need mitochondria. So it contains many mitochondria. Remember that mitochondria in every cell, it is that organelle that gives energy. I'm sure we've been studying the cell from grade 9 now. So the mitochondria, it is the one that gives the cell energy. So in this case, the proximal convoluted tubule has got many mitochondria. And that mitochondria will do what? Will give energy. So it is to give energy. Is to give energy. So that mitochondria wants to give what? To give energy. To give energy for the process of tubular reabsorption. so to give energy for tubular reabsorption, because that is the process that takes place there at the proximal convoluted tubule. So if the proximal convoluted tubule has got more mitochondria, that mitochondria will produce a lot of energy through a process called cellular respiration, of course. So that energy that is produced by the mitochondria after Krebs cycle, it is the one that will give energy for tubular reabsorption to take place or to occur. Then now the other thing is that the proximal convoluted tubule has got many microvilli. So it contains microvilli. Remember that microvilli always increases surface area. So whenever you say something contains microvilli, that microvilli increases surface area. To increase surface area, for tubular reabsorption, or for the absorption of for the absorption of nutrients back into the blood. So there are many more adaptations of the proximal convoluted tubule, maybe about 6 of them that can make up to 12 marks, but they just wanted to hear. The other adaptation is that the proximal convoluted tubule, it is proximal. It is convoluted. I mean, it means that it seems like a snake, something like this. So because it has got this shape, or it is convoluted, it means that it becomes easy for the what? For the nutrients to leak out of the what? Out of the proximal convoluted tubule. The other adaptation that's there is that the proximal convoluted tubule has got, it is lined with squamous epithelium, if I'm not mistaken, so that absorption can take place efficiently. There are many more adaptations which you can look for, but for now I'm just going to give you 2 of these. So if you have more, you can even put them in the comments, then others will also benefit from them. But anyways, thank you for watching this video. Don't forget to subscribe.